Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Pray in our own way. And as you do, I'd like for you to remember why we're here, that this governing body may make the very best decisions that are best for our community. Please remember our county staff who faithfully carry out the work of government. And please remember the strife that we've encountered in our society over the past few weeks, and that we may dedicate ourselves to live in peace, with love for one another, with respect for diversity and inclusiveness. So let's have a moment of silence.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, please stand for a pledge of allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. We have two public speakers today. First one's signed up electronically, Mr. Eddie Shue.
Good morning, Commissioner.
Morning, sir.
I don't like to read, but I am going to read a little bit of this. I've sent Clyde from the Institute of Government. I've sent Clyde a more detailed part, and the whole thing can be online. For example, the Second Circuit Court of Appeals has held that once the board decides to make public comments in a particular meeting, it may not discriminate amongst speakers on the basis of what they have to say in the subject at hand, and it cites the case. The time that a local board of education had allowed to hear public comments had expired, but the board continued to permit members of the public to speak. A citizen who said something that one member did not like was silent and eventually arrested. And the court noted that a rational jury would infer that the plaintiff was singled out because of the board members' dislike of what they had to say, and it goes on and on. Tony Cox, I did not know this board had the authority to charge somebody and impose a penalty from the bench. These rules that you have, when they made them, I was concerned with them because they're subjective. For instance, we had a speaker that called people treasons, their ancestors treason, to us being guilty of treason the other week. Well, from what I find, most of my North Carolina ancestors fought for the North, but I did find some out in Arkansas had the same name that fought for the South. So, you know, I don't know whether my ancestors were Benedict Arnolds or what they were, but I was offended. Further, you made this rule threat. I've never heard Tony Cox threaten this board. I've been threatened to come here. I was specifically said that if you show up, that something be done to you. I came, they didn't have no metal detectors, and the person I suspect made the comment has a concealed carry. I'm a little cautious coming across the street, but I showed up to the meeting because it's my right. The profanity, profanity is protected speech under the Constitution. Pornography is not. But the real issue is how can you take a member of this audience, so you basically charge him with doing something, went and imposed a 6-month penalty, and I cannot find anywhere in any statute you have the authority to do that. If there is such a statute, please tell me under the open meeting law. Have Clyde email it. I don't want to ask no questions it requires to answer. Really, they don't. I think in our hearts, we know that was a wrong action. Whether anybody ever admitted, I don't know.
Thank you, Mr. Chief.
Has it been 3 minutes?
Yes, sir.
Darn that fast. I'm going to buy me that clock. My days are good.
Thank you, sir. Next, we have Mr. Henry Vines.
Thank you. Thank you, Commissioners, for the opportunity to come to you and speak to you today. What I'd like to talk to the Commissioners about today is about this performance-based budgeting, which this was established back in July the 1st in 2012. As reported in the Times News, there was a savings of $4.5 million in 2012-2013 budget. And as reported, $2.5 million of that stayed within departments, and two went to the fund balance. Well, folks, I'd like to ask, I said, I can understand this as, performance and trying to get the best out of our employees that we can. But, we pay them a good salary, and we, as, it says in the Bible, a salary for a good day's work. I think that our benefit should be that, we expect a good service out of a good pay, and we shouldn't have to bribe our employees to do a better job to give us, the service that we require. And as a citizen, if there is benefits for savings of this, why is this money not returned back to the taxpayers, the money that who belongs to? We are the ones that furnish that money. So at $4.5 million, that would have been enough to offset this 4 cent raise that we just got on our taxes. I hadn't really thought about saying anything much about this, but when I got my taxes this week, and it was a substantial increase, Commissioners, I think that if performance-based budgeting is done and there is savings, then that savings ought to be returned back to the people who initially give the money. That's the taxpayers. I think that we ought to require each department to do the best job they can with the monies that they ask for. And if we have savings among each of these departments, then there must be budgeting a little bit high. And so I would ask that y'all look at this and reconsider this thing. I know there was a lot of I spoke at the time it was talked about, and some of the commissioners were in favor and some of the commissioners weren't. So please, I think that you need to reconsider this. If we can do these savings, that's fine, but I think these savings ought to be returned back to the general coffers of the county, which would put monies in place to carry out our yearly budgets. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Brown. Appreciate it. All right, any commissioners' responses to our speakers today? Mm-hmm. Hearing none, we'll move on to the approval of the agenda for today. Is any changes, any commissioners would like to change any portion of the agenda? Do I have a motion for approval of the agenda?
Motion to approve.
Motion.
I second.
Second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Thank you. Item number 6, consent agenda. Any items to be pulled from the consent agenda? Hearing none, do I have a motion for approval of the consent agenda?
So moved.
Second.
Second.
Second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Thank you. All right, moves on to item number 7, which is our...
Mr. Chairman, excuse me.
Yes, sir.
Right quick.
Yes, sir.
Okay. And again, I apologize for the chairman I talked to earlier. One of the things we did want to recognize at this time is the board is aware we have had quarterly employee award winners that we have recognized, and that we have had sore breakfasts that we've recognized those employees that have been nominated. And at this point, it's been a year since that program has been implemented, and we do have our yearly award winner. And our yearly award winner for SOAR, for our employee recognition, is Ms. Brenda Perry.
All right.
And if I can read Brenda's nomination, the employee of the year started work for the county in January 1991. She has risen through the ranks to be the assistant service officer of her department in October 2000, and later promoted to Veteran Service Director in 2014. Her brainchild and passion was to see Alamance County honor its veterans with their own parade. She saw that dream realized in 2014. Now that the parade is part of the county landscape, she will continue for many years to come. She continues to work tirelessly for the veterans of this county. Each veteran and their needs becomes her personal mission. It is with great pleasure that the Alamance County announces its very first Employee of the Year as Ms. Brenda Perry. We had Brenda's daughter here, and that's the reason why we wanted to make sure we got that done first, so I apologize for the interruption. But Brenda, we love you, thank you, and we appreciate what you do. So, okay. Thank you.
Given the quarterly award, I was totally overwhelmed, and I'm even more overwhelmed today with this. I can't explain what this means to me, but I have to say this belongs to my veterans as well. They are my heart and soul of this county, and I have worked very hard to provide for them. It goes without saying, too, I have a wonderful co-worker, Tammy. She's awesome, she's amazing, and she will eventually be taken over in my position. But I thank everybody, I thank the committee for this. I really don't know what to say. I am truly honored, and I'm proud to be an employee of Alamance County. I have a wonderful boss, a wonderful co-boss, and they really have supported us in our efforts, and the board as well, especially with this parade. So thank you again. I'm truly honored.
Thank you. Brenda, we certainly appreciate the job you've done, and I'm telling you, that parade every year, I mean, just honoring the veterans, and just the way it went last year was such a great thing for Alamance County, and we just thank you for that endeavor and for the job you do. Thank you. All right, public hearing, we have two today. Mr. Mac Williams, approval of economic incentives, GKN. We'll start with that one.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Commissioners, we do indeed have two economic development projects to talk about this morning, and you're going to hear details on both of them. We'll start with GKN, who has a proposal for a facility in Mebane, and followed by NIPRO, which also has a facility plan for Mebane. And before I introduce the folks, I just want to remind the commissioners and the public that should these occur and officially announce, and I hope they will, that this will be number 5 and number 6 for projects that have made announcements in Alamance County just in this year. Since January, we've had 4 other announcements to make it official that Alamance County is going to be their home base. Those 4 projects represent 279 announced jobs and about $140 million of capital and investment. And these 2 projects will add to those totals. So we're very pleased that Alamance is being considered by new projects, but also, even more importantly, that like these 2 projects represent a place to continue to grow. GKN and NIPRO have both been longtime corporate citizens in Alamance County, have prospered here. They've got other opportunities, but I think Alamance is a good option for them, and we hope that you will support their option as you take action on these requests. For GKN, the person representing the company this morning is Jim Malone. Jim is the project manager for the Freight Services Division, which is the piece of GKN's business that is contemplating the move here. So I will let Jim come up. I think there's a presentation, Jim, that you want to speak to, and then we'll answer questions and take action from there. Thank you for being here.
Thank you. Good to have you, sir. Good morning. We appreciate, as part of the GKN family, to be here this morning. Again, I
My name is Jim Malone. I am the Supply Chain and Projects Manager for the Americas. My responsibilities include all GKN operations in North America, Mexico, and Brazil. Just some background on GKN. GKN was founded in 1759. We located to Mebane with our Alamance plant in early 1980. Since 2011, we have completed expansions of our existing facility, adding about $47.3 million in taxable value, and we've added 170 jobs. The size of our current building is 400,000 square feet, and we're on a 70-acre parcel of property. Some of the products that we manufacture at the Alamance site that are supported by our other sites in North Carolina, we have all-wheel drive axles, the CV joints. This thing on the bottom left is affectionately referred to as a spider. We have we manufacture for all of the largest car makers in Detroit, and we also have a very significant overseas customer base, and we do a lot of work for the transplants, especially BMW down in South Carolina. Our current project scope, we're investing about $6.3 million in a 134,000 square foot state-of-the-art distribution facility. It will currently able to expand another 100,000 square feet, so we're looking at a possibility in the next 5 years of it being 234,000 square feet. It will support our manufacturing facilities in Sanford, Roxboro, or Timberlake, depending on how you want to split that hair, and the site here in Alamance. We're investing about $579,000 in new equipment. It will be a freight services and logistics hub for us. There'll be 13 new jobs, average wage of about $55,000, include benefits. And 13 jobs are being transferred from a site that we're moving from. We're actually consolidating the site. The timeline for start of this project, we want to be fully functional by March 31st, 2016. And we're also pursuing the establishment of a foreign trade zone. About 40% of everything that we manufacture gets either exported to a out of the country or to another customer that runs an FTZ. The site location is in the business park. If you've been by the area, the walls are up. We're actually putting the roof on the building right now. The performance agreement, 2% of taxable investments up to $100,000, paid over 5 years, which would be $20,000 a year. Reimbursement of construction fees at $50,000. We are adding $6.3 million in taxable base, 13 jobs, and there is a clawbacks provision that's been negotiated. So in the fiscal analysis over 5 years, property tax and fees $123,000, incentives $150,000 is net $26,000 over 10 years. You can see those numbers there, $262,000, $150,000, and $112,000. And that's my presentation. If I can answer any questions, I will.
Good questions from the commissioners.
Mr. Chairman, I do want to say that both of these projects have gone through the process in Mebane, and the incentives have been approved by the city of Mebane as well for both these projects, very similar to what we're looking at as well.
I do have one. Didn't you say your building's already up?
It's well, I should say, we like to refer to it as under construction. When the walls go up, we consider it we're moving. The project, we're actually looking at a move-in date sometime beginning of February.
So it's going to be pretty fast track once you get things.
Yeah, we're trying to consolidate quite a bit, and we're also going through a modification of our ERP system, so all these things are kind of coming together at once for us.
Just out of curiosity, you mentioned you sell to BMW in South Carolina. I'm curious as to why you didn't try to locate closer to manufacturer. Are they just a small percentage?
I shouldn't say they're a small percentage. I think our goal was to support our current plants in Sanford, Mebane, and Timberlake, Roxboro, and we felt that the Mebane site, after a 4-month exhaustive process, was our best option as a logistics center. Our access to I-40, the ports in Norfolk and Wilmington, and then the ability to come across the country from L.A. And the Long Beach port was pretty vital in those decisions.
So you like Alamance County?
We do like Alamance County.
This is, excuse me.
Well, thank you for being here, and I support what you're doing, of course. And looking at the agreement, and I was trying to calculate some of the benefit to the county. So the way this works is that we don't pay anything, and Greg, you tell me if I'm misunderstanding this. We don't pay anything until after your investment has been made and the jobs are hired, people are hired in those jobs. And then, in my calculation, based on the investment, they'd be paying taxes of over $36,000 per year. And we start paying them reimbursement for help with your construction and purchasing of equipment and all in the amount of $18,837 per year. So one question, so that's a net cash inflow to us. It's not really costing taxpayers any cash.
And we don't pay the incentive until the taxes have been paid.
Right. So it's kind of like a rebate, kind of is the methodology.
It is a grant based back to the corporation.
Yes,
and that's based upon taxes paid.
And that's exactly how the agreement reads.
Yes, sir.
Kind of like Andy Griffith at that time when that word slipped out of his mouth. Bob, and he wanted to slip it back in.
Not a rebate.
So, but I have two questions, I guess. So the tax that we get of $36,000 per year assumes that the tax value remains constant. And but I do have a question about some of that investment is in equipment, and equipment depreciates, and particularly if you're doing it on an accelerated method of depreciation. So does that decrease the tax value when that equipment depreciates?
The clawbacks that we have in the agreement is the incentive is based upon the $6.2 million. And if it falls below, and we will check the valuations on an annual basis, if it falls below the $6.2 million, then the incentive will be based upon that new valuation. However, and we've had this happen in the past before, that if they invest more than $6.2 million, and let's say they put $6.4 million in, our incentive is still based off the $6.2.
And I think he said they're going to probably do $5 million more. Over a period of time.
There's another 100,000. We have a pad that's being developed attached to this facility, so for tilt walls, quick move if we need to.
Right.
But it's based on actuals, and again, there's some, and Clyde's done a very good job on the clawbacks in the agreement that we check the jobs, we check the valuations with our tax department, and they do a wonderful job on an annual basis. To ensure that what they're asking for is what they're actually paying taxes off of.
Okay. So if that does adjust in depreciation or whatever, our payment adjusts also,
right.
Is that correct?
Right, but if it goes up, if they invest more than they expect, our payment does not go past $18,000.
I always like to look at all sides of an issue, so other people have also talked to me about these sorts of incentives about do we really need to do this? Particularly, I mean, would the company come here, or in this case, would the company expand without our assistance? And, well, I don't know, but one thing I would say is though, by doing this, I think we're sending out a message to industry that we're industry friendly.
We're open for business.
We're open for business, and it's important. We need to be increasing our tax base. It's necessary to help pay for our schools and keep our tax rates down in the future. So,
quite a few houses for $6 million. I mean, and less
thank
impact.
You, thank you, sir. We
thank
appreciate
you.
It. And this is a public hearing. Once we vote that it is a public hearing, commissioners, I need a motion and a second that we are in a public hearing.
Motion to go in public
motion.
Hearing.
I'll second. Those in favor signify by saying aye.
Uh-huh.
Aye. Those no. Thank you, sir. And this is a public hearing. I'll start on this side. Any members of the, any citizens like to speak on the economic incentive for GKN on this side? Sir, please come forward and identify yourself.
Morning, my name is Brian Hall from Samet.
Yes, sir.
Appreciate your support of our industrial park. It's a great project. We're working hard constructing a couple of speculative industrial buildings out there. We do this to attract the type of folks that you hear from today. So we appreciate your support of GKN. Appreciate your continued support of our industrial park. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Appreciate it. Any others from this side like to be heard? All right. Hearing none, we'll move to this side. Any folks, any citizens on this side like to be heard on the GKN economic incentive? Mr. Vines?
Thank you, Commissioner. Appreciate
yes,
the opportunity to speak to you.
Yes, sir.
While I certainly welcome economic development in our county, I have to stand and say that I'm opposed to keep giving incentives. These are companies that we have already initially have given incentives, and I would think that this is good business sense to make an investment and an enlargement. When we say this is an improvement to our tax base, certainly it is. But when we return that money back to them, that actually decreases the tax base, the tax revenues that are going to come in, which when the needs are there, then it's passed on back to the public, to the landowners, and the other business owners. Commissioners, I have to say, you know, what if every business and every industry in this county came before you and wanted you to invest in their expansion? Would you be willing to give them some money to help them along? I think that incentives were established to bring in new perspectives when you were fighting against somebody else to bring in a large industry that would bring several thousand jobs. I think that's what it was initially begin with. I think that asking the taxpayers, and you are asking the taxpayers to help, because when you take the revenues away from the coffers, that makes it less what you got to ask us for some money to make the bills. I welcome, you know, industry in here and the to help our people that need jobs. Our economy right now is low. Our unemployment is as low as it's ever been. I mean, I've got to wonder, why do we got to keep on giving incentives? Why do we have to? I mean, we're a good place to come. As he has said, this location is the reason they're here is because it's centrally located between their other businesses. It's a good, smart move. Why do we have to continue bribing people to come to our county? Why do we have to keep giving them money to invest in their adventure from the taxpayers' money? I sure wish y'all would take this into consideration. I think that, you know, incentives have been a vital part in helping, but I think that we're overextended. I mean, you know, like I said, this will be the sixth or seventh incentive we've given in the past year or whatever. So think about this, gentlemen. I mean, you know, y'all just hit us for a 4-cent increase, and then you're giving other folks a decrease. Thanks.
Thank you. That's fine. Any other citizens on this side like to be heard? All right. In the room, any other citizens in the room like to be heard? Public hearing. All right, thank you. I'll take a motion at this time to close this public hearing.
Aye.
Motion to second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. All right. So on GKN, any further comments on GKN?
I had one for Brian. Mm-hmm. Is the rail spur that we approved the money for not long ago, is that integral to what you're doing there, or would that tie in? I don't know whether to ask you or Brian.
We constantly evaluate how we move things.
Right.
We would certainly very much like an LaPorte. If that can somehow be tied to the rail spur, which makes sense. If you go down to Greer, South Carolina, they have actually the second largest facility in South Carolina, and it rivals the Wilmington port in size. as far as number of containers processed, and that's almost 200 miles off the coast. So if that is ever entertained by the county, it would have our, I believe, our.
I was just interested. I think the rail spur was a good move for the county. Hopefully, it will benefit a number of people.
Further comments?
Yeah, I have two.
Judge?
First comment is I think we need a seminar for incentives. If the board doesn't understand what incentives are, how they work, then we need some education. Secondly, and this is kind of in answer to our public speaker on incentives. I've always been in favor of incentives. People say, you know, you're paying this and paying that and the county's losing money. Well, the way I look at it, it's a total investment. That's all it is. Just like any business, it's a total investment in the future. And the only way we're going to grow and build in this county is to compete with other places like South Carolina, who's eating our lunch every day with every kind of company that wants to expand in the South. So we've got to wake up and start doing something right, and that, I think this county has been doing it for a number of years. Those incentives, yeah, the first 5, 6, 7 years, I think that we pay out in 6 or 7 years, one or the other. After that, it's all gravy. It's an investment. That's all it is. It's like any business going out investing, just like you invest for your future, for your retirement. And I'm totally in favor of it, and I'll vote for everyone that comes in here. And if every business in Alamance County wants to expand and meet our ground rules, which all of the companies do who come in here, then by golly, we've got to consider giving them the incentives. And I think in the long run, it's going to pay off. I'm tired of listening to all this chit-chat and all that stuff. Keep going on and on and on because they don't know what it is or they're campaigning or whatever. Judge, let's move on.
Judge, I'll take it as a motion for approval of this.
Amen. Judge, I'll second the motion on that one because we're netting $17,000 a year on this one. Taxpayers would have to pick that up should they decide to go somewhere.
Well, I would say that these companies do have, particularly the two before us today, they operate in a lot of different locations. They have choices. So I think we want to.
We have a motion and a second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Thank you. Mr. Williams, we have another, approval of economic incentive, NIPRO. So welcome back to speak on NIPRO.
It's hard to follow that, Mr. Smith, Judge. But I'm pleased to do so. I'm pleased to do so, and thank you for that support. NIPRO, like GKN, longtime employer here in Alamance County, has been supported by this council and Mebane on a couple of other projects. Mebane used to be an employee-owned company, and now they are part of a company called Jabil, J-A-B-I-L. And so it's with Jabil's advancement of this project that I'm pleased to introduce Hector Murillo, who's the manufacturing manager for NIPRO. With him is the plant manager Richard Champney, who are both here to support NIPRO's request for their expansion, which would be a $17 million roughly project with 75 new jobs and I think some enhancements. You've got some temps there that would move to perm. Yep. As well. So NIPRO continues to grow. I think, to your point, I think the rail spur coming in would be ultimately, if we can work it out, of some help to NIPRO with bringing the plastic pellets in for them. But we're still working on that. But anything we can do to support them, as we are doing now, would be just all to the good. So I'm here to introduce Hector, who will present the project that NIPRO is considering and answer any questions you may have.
Thank you. Welcome, sir.
Good morning, commissioners. Thank you for taking the time to listen to us. So I've got a presentation here that I'll go through, just a little, some facts about NIPRO. NIPRO manufactures a wide range of healthcare and packaging consumer electronic products, founded in 1955. And as Mac spoke to, in 1998, we became an ESOP company. Recently, we've converted that, and we are now a public company. In 2007, we located in the Mebane. Just from a facts perspective, Nipro first plant in Alamance County was in 1988 off Anthony Road. So we have a long-standing relationship here in the county. In 2013, we joined forces with J-Bill. And in 2014, we completed an expansion of the existing facility, adding about 6.9 taxable value and about 50 jobs to the Alamance area. Again, just some of our products. We make healthcare devices, and we make packaging. The healthcare devices are actually life-saving devices for the individuals in the medical field. Project scope, investment of $17 million, the lease new of a 137,000 square foot manufacturing facility, about $6 million. $8 million equipment at the existing molding plant, and upfit the new, upfit equipment in the new facility. Jobs, this would be an assembly, warehouse, automation, and planning. That would be the jobs that would be at this facility. About 75 new jobs with an average wage of about $34,500. Then we've got a converting of 80 existing temporary jobs to 60 full-time positions at Nipro. Currently, retain the current 170 full-time jobs with about an average of $40,000 salary, and then another 50 temporary jobs. When this is all said and done, it would be right around 300-plus positions in this business park for Nipro. Timeline is about 3 years, starting from October of 2015. So just from a location perspective, so Nipro currently is right here. Again, we did expand this building, and then we would be up in this area would be the spec building, which is about the, 137,000 square feet. And that's what we've got.
Questions from commissioners? So based on my calculations, based on their investment, they're going to pay us $98,000 in taxes. We're going to help them pay for their equipment in over a five-year period after they've already made their investment of just a little over half that, around 50, almost $51,000 per year. So that's a net cash of tax revenue, not to mention the impact of all of the jobs. And the people that are put to work constructing the facility, and et cetera, et cetera. Do I have that right?
Yes, sir.
I think you're correct. I did the math this morning for you.
Any further? Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Do I have a motion that we go into public hearing at this time?
So moved.
Second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, again, this is a public hearing on the economic incentive request for Nipro. And I will start on this side this time. Any members of the general public like to speak on the Nipro request for economic incentives? All right, seeing none, I will move to this side. Any members of the general public like to speak? Yes, sir. Please come up in 5 seconds.
Brian Hall from Samet. Thank you. Nipro has been a long-term customer of ours, a great partner. They have been ever since they were here in Graham. We ask for your support. Appreciate your continued support of us. Thank you.
Thank you, Brian. Okay, any other folks like to speak on this economic incentive? By hearing none, I have a motion that we go out of the public hearing.
Motion to go out of public hearing.
I'll second. Those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. All right, commissioners, any further comments, or do I have a motion?
Move. Second.
All right, Judge, a motion that we approve this economic incentive for Nipro, seconded by our Vice Chair. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Thank you. Thank you, gentlemen. Thank you, Mac.
Yep.
Appreciate that.
Thank you, folks.
Mm-hmm. All right, next we have a request for funding for the Graham Christmas lights.
Hello. I appreciate the time y'all listening to us this morning. My name is Chuck Talley.
Good.
I'm co-chair with John Harrington here of the Graham Area Business Association. I just want to tell you a little bit about the association, since probably none of y'all have ever heard of it. This association was established in 1950. All right. In 1960, it started the Graham Christmas Parade. The responsibilities of the association is we purchase the flags in the downtown area. We also put them up. It's not the city. We do that as an association. We are responsible, of course, for the Christmas lights and also the Christmas Parade, which was started, like I said, in 1960. So this is the 55th year that we've done the Christmas Parade. Our relationship with the county and been participating with our organization goes all the way back to the Larry Scott when he was a county manager in his era. We are also responsible putting the wreaths at the courthouse, and every year they would contribute money to the association to help cover our expenses with those lights, those wreaths that we used to hang on the wrought iron light poles. With the price of expenses and stuff, 20 years ago we had come before you guys and also the city of Graham to help raise the money to purchase the lights, and I think you've all been given a quote what the lights cost. Every year our association, we have possibly about 60 paid members. Most of them, I'd say 98% of them, are mom-and-pa shops, which economically 28% more revenue stay in town with a small business than it does with a corporation, if y'all don't understand that. But we're good for the community, and we do stuff for our community. The expenses that are associated with our dues every year, I thought y'all need to know this, is we do purchase flags on an annual basis due to the fact of weathering. We buy the banners. We also have to buy about $1,200 worth of bulbs every year. And of course, all the expenses are associated with the parade, which basically we're a nonprofit, so we don't have a lot of money in the account. It's a wash for us. We don't want to overcharge any business or anybody that wants to participate in the parade, because that defeats the purpose of us saying we thank the community for doing business with us. I think that other than that, I mean, we could really use some help. I'll let John say a few things, and before I sit down, I was bringing y'all's attention that we are going to move the parade tonight this year. It'll be the 1st December, and the first Saturday in December, and it'll start at 6, and line up will be around 4. So I appreciate any consideration we can get on this. I'd like it if you could contribute something.
Commissioners, how lucky are we to have the county seat here in downtown Graham? I mean, that's fantastic, and Graham always is very beautiful at Christmas time, and we want to keep that tradition alive. And the Christmas lights we have now are in very desperate despair. I mean, they are having to be worked on constantly every year, wondering if some will even be able to be hung. Brackets are rusting, wiring is completely almost just fried. And these new lights, we also have LED lights, which are cost-efficient lights that'll help the city and the county keep costs down as far as running the Christmas lights with Duke Energy. Also, we're lucky enough to have the City of Graham to house the Christmas lights, which are owned by the Graham Area Business Association, that we are fortunate enough to be able to raise the money each year to keep replacing other light bulbs, which we're fortunate enough again to have the City of Graham do the maintenance for us at no cost, and housing at the city garage. And we just ask for everything you're willing to give to we keep these traditions. And this year, with the Christmas parade being moved tonight, we're really wanting to brighten up downtown Graham this year, get people back downtown Graham. That's what we want, everybody to light up with the fireworks show. We're trying to keep people downtown to enjoy a full Christmas experience with the lighting of the tree, the fireworks ceremony, and the parade itself, which is, you know, not to brag on the Graham Area Business Association, but our Christmas parade is quite well known and well thought of, and I'm quite proud of it, to be a part of it. And guys and ladies, we just come here today to get help. You know, the business association doesn't have a lot of funds available. Like I said, we're lucky enough to raise the money each year to keep the maintenance on them. But anything you all are willing to do to help along with the city, we are very grateful for anything. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you all very much.
Thank you.
Comments?
Craig, did the City of Graham, I know that there's some discussion with the manager, Frankie Manis.
Right.
Did they?
They've not budgeted any funds at this time, at least that was the email that I got from Frankie. They've not budgeted any funds at this time, so I don't think you've made a formal request yet.
Tomorrow night.
Of Graham, so they'll make that formal request tomorrow night.
One thing I would say, and I'd like to hear what the other commissioners have to say. We went through this budgeting process, and even to keep our tax increase to 5 cents, we had to do a lot of cutting throughout the county departments. And it just seems like we have this budget, and it was a tough budget to get through. And I don't know, it doesn't seem like it's a good time, given our budget constraints, to do this sort of a, fund this sort of a project. But I mean, I understand how nice it would be, and I understand too that there's an opportunity to get a good buy on the lights, and but this kind of expenditure, I'd just as soon have it budgeted. But I'd like to hear what others have to say.
My thoughts on this is we have a lot of municipalities. Next thing you know, Mayor Williams will be here wanting some money for his city. And the city of Burlington and all the other municipalities. I think it's great what you guys do, and I do realize we are in the county seat. But like Bob said, had this been presented in our budget, I would have thought more about it, and I appreciate you bringing it to our attention maybe next year.
Any further comments? All right. Thank you, gentlemen. I don't hear a motion, so we'll just wait if once you've talked with Graham, and you can get back with our county manager. If we need to bring it back up and address it, we can. But I think sounds like folks have pretty much got their mind made up on this endeavor from what I'm hearing. So thank you. All right, moving on to the tax annual settlement of 2014-2015 taxes, Jeremy Akins.
Good morning, Commissioners.
Morning.
Thank you for having me here today. I should have, there it is, a slideshow. I'm a clicker. You know, every year the citizens of Alamance County entrust a portion of their revenues, their finances, to this board, to this county, to be used for our purposes. This board then entrusts that to me as your tax collector to bring in the revenue and make sure that we have that available. This is the one time a year that I bring a settlement and give an account for how we have performed in the past year with those revenues coming in. There we go. So just a brief overview. The 2015 levy, we had $61,746,207.20. We collected $60,708,150.11, with a total uncollected of $1,038,057.09. This is a collection rate of 98.32%. Now, this is general fund revenue. The question that we have then is 98.32, a good rate, a bad rate, how does that compare? If we look at our history, the last 5 years, you can see that we've had increases. I guess last year was an increase, this year is an increase. Back in 9, we had another step up, so comparing to 9 is a pretty strong increase. Average over 5 years is 97.22%, so we're 1.1% above our 5-year average. If we're comparing ourselves by the back years, we're looking pretty good right now. Now, I will say there's something you have to look at to get good apples to apples, and that's excluding registered motor vehicles. As you know, the DMV has taken over collection of motor vehicles. That has changed our situation because motor vehicles were the most difficult category to collect. We were getting 85 to 87% of those. So that's been lifted from our shoulders. To get real apples to apples, when you exclude motor vehicles, we're still up 0.19%, which I think is a strong increase. We're up 0.32% off of our 5-year average. So if the question is, are we doing well? Comparing to the last 5 years, yes, we are. But what if we compared to our neighbors? How are we doing compared to them? Now, every year the Department of Revenue issues a report of collections rates, and they go ahead and they group us. There's 27 counties that are in our grouping, which are counties with populations of 100,000 or more, but they're not all good comparables. You've got mountain counties and coastal counties. Those usually aren't a good comparison. And then you want to find your closest comparables. We compare by population, population density, total valuation and valuation density, median household income, and a value per capita. To try to find the counties that are the most similar to us in their collection task. When we do this, the top five are Davison, Rowan, Catawba, Pitt, and Johnston counties. As you can see, on average, they're very close to our population figures, valuation figures. They're a pretty decent match, and on average, they're at 97.84 versus our 98.32. And of course, we use the excluding registered motor vehicles because these are last year's rates for them. And why do we use last year's rates? These are certified rates. This is my ability to guarantee that the numbers you see are real numbers. If you pick up the phone and call them, you can have a surprise. So we use DOR certified rates, which are 1 year in arrears. But by excluding the registered motor vehicles, we're still pretty much an apples to apples. And we're stronger than the average. So I would tend to say that we have a good collection rate. I do want to point out, though, Johnston County, 99.71 certified rate. Wow.
Did you find out how they did that?
I'm going to be making a phone call. I was at the North Carolina Tax Collectors Association meeting, and they were actually honored at the dinner because of that collection rate. So whatever they did, we're going to find out. And I'm extremely pleased, I think you can tell, with the 98.32%. I looked back into our records, and I was hoping I had the record. Jack Hensley had us at 98.99. So my new goal is 99% because I want the record. Now, if you look at dollars collected, you're going to see something very sharp right here. What happened? Every year, revenue is going up, and all of a sudden, it plummets down to 60. And what's going on? Again, we've been relieved of the vehicles. So if you put the DMV tag and tax monies back in, we're up again this year. Every year, we're seeing stronger and stronger revenue growth. I'm going to go on record and say I was a skeptic. I thought this was probably not a good deal for Alamance County because I don't like to pay other people to do work we could do ourselves. They have a 99.6 collection rate for their vehicles versus our 85.87. So even when you take out what we're paying them, it's a revenue generator. So I'm eating my words and saying that it is a good thing, that it is healthy for our budget. You look at the uncollected tax. You can see it's gone up every year. That's normally something that would be alarming, but if you look at a percentage, the percentage is pretty flat. Every year there's more levy, there's more collected, there's more uncollected. It's just the pie is getting larger, so the slices are getting larger. But what that tells me is I've got 1.8 million out there that I need to go and get, and those are back years. We have 1 million in the current 2014, so that's 2.8 million of delinquent taxes due to Alamance County. And so we're working very hard to bring that money in, of course, in addition to the timely 2015s that are just now starting to come in. I do want to give you just kind of a outlook for the future year. How are we going to bring those dollars in? We have started working with mass enforcement. That's a large part of our increase this year, and we're going to double down with that. We think it's very effective. Just a short synopsis of what that is. The old way that you would do a garnishment, for example, is you would research the one person that had not paid taxes. You'd find their employer, and then you'd serve that person. You'd serve the employer and say, look, we have unpaid taxes. We need to remedy this. And you'd do that individual by individual. Now, if I've got an employer, for example, with 30 employees, if it's a larger company that have delinquent, I send one letter. And I tell that employer, you got 30 employees, here's the amounts remit from those 30 employees. That makes us faster, more efficient. It cuts down on the notice fees to the persons that are being garnished. I think that it's a win. The payroll departments prefer to be told one time and then be done with it. Mm-hmm. So we're definitely going to push harder on mass enforcements to try to get that rate up further. Another thing I've mentioned the last couple of years, and I'll probably mention every year that I'm here, is continuing an efficiency study and model calibration. Things change in any industry. They change in ours. And if you're not constantly watching to see what's giving you the best return, sooner or later you become inefficient. So my question is, the dollars per hour we pay, plus any materials cost, compared to the revenues that come in the door, what is giving us the biggest return per dollar? Where do we put our resources? Based on that, we've adjusted our work last year. We're going to run that again very soon. We'll adjust our work for the coming year so that we're being as efficient as possible. The last thing I want to mention is kind of a thank you. In our budget, we asked for an additional delinquent collector position, and just wanted to touch on that ever so briefly. Thank you for approving that and allowing us to have that. There's a concept, you know, if you take someone to court and you're suing, you say, by the way, not only do I want my damages, but I want you to pay for my attorney. So you put the attorney's fees in. We kind of do that. If I have got to go after somebody for delinquent taxes, not only do I want the taxes, I want them to pay for my enforcement. And so those positions generate fees to cover their cost. Those fees have been paying for about 70% of what we pay them. So these positions are discount employees. We only pick up the tab on the 30% because they generate the 70%. As far as return on investment, that 30% on average is coming out 20 times over. That's like asking you to give me a dollar to give you 20. That's a very good return on our money. This is a net positive to our revenue. And all the monies come from persons who have not been paying. Those faithful taxpayers that have always been coming in, they're not the ones funding it. And so I just wanted to thank you for being willing to step forward with me on that. That's all I have as far as the settlement. Are there any questions?
If you had one thing to that contributed to your rate, what would that one thing be?
I would say the main thing, well, I'm going to say two different things if you'll allow me. The real main thing, I think, are my staff. Cindy Miller down there working really hard, and the folks that work with her. You know, I can support and I can direct, but at the end of the day, it's their hard work that generates revenue.
Right.
As far as a technique, the mass enforcements have just been a godsend, because now we're not retreading the same path. If I go out and I find one person this year, next year, that's going to be an automated process. So I'm not redigging over and over and over.
Was that a statutory change from mm-hmm. General Assembly?
That's something we've been able to do. It's not so much a statutory change, but a change in the technology. It's something we could have always done, but we've been lagging behind. Other counties have been doing that. And talk about keeping your efficiencies up, we haven't kept up. Implementing that each year will reap more returns, because on the front end, you have to do that single, but next year it's grouped in and you press a button.
We're looking for 99% next year.
That's it, right.
So, Jeremy, you're needing an authorization from this board today
indeed.
On the order of collection so that you may begin collecting current taxes.
Indeed. There's three things. There's the settlement. There is also a charge-off of 05 property taxes, okay. Which will require resolution. The statutes cut off my enforcement powers as of September 1st. With a 10-year span. So as of September 1st, our 2005 taxes, I'll have no collection power. Yeah, right. So historically, every September 1st, whatever's remaining, we write off. I'll say as of the close of the fiscal year, that was about $110,000 in general fund that we've been digging on for 10 years. It's not coming our way. So that requires a resolution by the board.
Okay, so three things I think you just mentioned to me.
Sure.
One's the settlement, the other's the 05 write-off,
yep.
And then the third is the ordinance for the enforcement.
Yes, indeed. There's an order of tax collection, and what this does is it charges me with collection of 2015 taxes. Now, obviously, we're taking payments over the counter right now. That's perfectly allowable, but we do need to get the order signed so that we can go forward, especially as enforcements begin next year. That'll already be on the books.
I will make a motion to that effect. Do I have a second?
Is this covering all three?
All three.
Okay, second that motion.
Those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Thank you, Jeremy.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. All right, next we have Sandra Webster, maintenance register of deeds.
This change has been a little change since
I want to thank employees of Alamance County and all the people of Alamance County for the support and friendship, expressions of sympathy they forwarded to us during the passage of my mother-in-law at almost 102 years old.
Okay.
She lived with us except for a period of absence when she broke a leg for about 30 years. And she used to be the sweetest thing in the world because she got dementia. But that happens. probably going to happen to me and you too.
It's coming.
Yeah. But anyhow, she was buried Saturday, and we had really nice people here. I want to point out to you, now I know this is not something that y'all like to look at, all these numbers, but us accountants like to look at them. We like to make them up and look at them and
drive everybody else crazy with them, right?
Yeah. And this past fiscal year, we sent across the street from there to here $3,578,424.85. Now compared to Jeremy, that doesn't sound like much, but that's a pretty good move for registered deeds. We have 10 employees over there, and I had asked to speak with you about maintenance. Well, lo and behold, it changed. You know, so we're getting some maintenance now, and I don't need to say much about that except thank you. Thank y'all for trying to make that place livable. My employees adjusted and entitled to a decent place to live, to work, as the people that work in the courthouse, I think. And but there's a few things that needed doing, and they are getting done this past week. The other thing too is a lot of talk about new building, and I will agree with that as long as you don't mess with me. That building over there is old. Oh, actually, it's two buildings. It's old. But it serves its purpose. And ever since I've been there, which has been, four or five years now, I have been anticipating the time when we ran out of space to store papers. And there's been quite a bit of change over there. We don't have as much foot traffic in now because of the e-recording, and because we're able to get so much of it that people can access from their home or business computers. So, but we have to realize that you have to make sure that your digital records are up to date and backed up. And we are right now, hopefully next week or so, finishing up the process of digitizing, scanning all of our old records, all of them. And our, what we call vital records, which is births, marriages, and deaths, are getting worn out and getting dog-eared. Now we've got them scanned and they can look at them on the computer. And we can print them for them. We can print a certified copy without pulling them out of the book. So I want to thank y'all for remembering that, this old building over here, by the way, we had two air conditioners go out. And they needed some maintenance. It's what they needed. Now, another one is probably just going to go dead. It's going to die, but I'm looking to see if Jerry, air conditioner maintenance man was here. But maintenance is so important to keeping a building. you can't just ignore the maintenance and expect it to last forever. Now, I want to maintain it and have it last longer than I last. And then y'all can do what you want to do with it. But we have good parking, good access. I refer to it as a good mother-in-law distance from this building. You know what that means? Y'all over here if we need you. But you don't ask, but I anyway, I want to, well, apparently getting the painting finished, and I've asked that we pressure wash the outside of the building and repaint the part. They replaced the damaged overhang part and put new lights on it, and LED lights. And they did that last week. So I'm very glad that what I had to say to y'all has changed since I asked to speak to you.
Thank you, sir.
Thanks, sir. All right, next we have active presentation. Welcome.
Thank you, Commissioners. It's been a few months since I was last with you, and I wanted to take just a few minutes to update you on what's going on with ACTA, and appreciate all the work that you guys do. And Bob is here, who is on the ACTA board, and I noticed John Paisley's in the back here. It's always nice to have people of their caliber that supports ACTA. Let me take just a couple of minutes and run through a slide for you. First two or three slides I've given to you before, but let's just run through them real quick to tell you ACTA overview. We're a public authority that the commissioners established back in 2002. North Carolina General Statute 160, Article 25. Our board includes a TAC representative, Transportation Advisory Commission. Jim Albright's our chair, and then from the Burlington City Council, CeeLo Fawcett. And then the commissioners appoint three members, Bob Bird and John Paisley and Michael Snyder are on our board, all outstanding members. Our purpose, we provide transportation for elderly, disabled, and the general public using equipment that are wheelchair accessible. We do about 16% of our trips are by with wheelchair riders. We do all sorts of trips. They're medical, people going to dialysis, people going to work, going to community college, go shopping. We also have contract destinations. We do Medicaid work. We have several contracts with care facilities, health facilities. We do 300-350 trips a day, Monday through Friday. We do limited service on Saturday for dialysis riders. And our fleet, we're up to 27 vehicles. All of them except three minivans have lifts aboard. What's our mission? It's simply to provide safe, economical, and effective transportation for anybody in Alamance County. I say residents, but actually if you were visiting and you're registered with us from another county, we would take you somewhere as long as you're in Alamance County, and we pick you up in Alamance County and take you somewhere in Alamance County. How do we achieve this mission? We are focused on safety and providing great service, and we do excellent training and supervision of our staff. We constantly survey the changing transportation needs. We do continuous planning, which is coordinated, comprehensive, and also financial planning. We work with the FTA and the Department of Transportation. We work with agencies and businesses to try to meet their needs. And we could not do this unless we got the support from the county, and more recently, in the last two or three years, we've gotten some contributions from the cities also, the municipalities. We're able to take those local monies and match that with grants and collect a lot of money to be able to run all the trips that we run, 60 to 70,000 trips a year. Who can ride with ACTA? Like I say, anybody that is in Alamance County can ride with us. How much does it cost? We have a number of different programs depending on what you can qualify for. The fee ranges from, it costs the rider nothing, to $5 on a one-way trip. We operate Monday through Friday from 5 a.m. to 5:30 p.m. and Saturdays dialysis riders. We're closed on Sundays. Now let's go on and talk about where we're at and what we're planning to do here. Significant projects this year. We have recently upgraded our vehicles and also our dispatch and scheduling areas. We have vehicle tablets that have been installed in each vehicle, and it provides the driver's schedules, and it also helps us with the scheduling process. And if we're out in cancellations and things like that, we can automatically update the schedule real time. So it's a very efficient tool that we're going to prosper from. We're also, the first week in August, actually, we're going to be converting half of our fleet to propane. That's finally coming to fruition. That project is about $112,000, of which we only have to pay 10% of it. And the payback period is probably a couple of months. So that was a no-brainer. We're still working with the county to identify find a property that we can relocate to. It could be a county-provided property. As you're aware, the facility that we're in on Martin Street is being looked at in an overall scheme, and so we will relocate at some point. We're also looking through some realtors at some potential sites. We're continuing to replace vehicles. The last 2 years we've replaced probably 60% of our vehicles, so we've got a fairly new fleet, and we're continuing to build our operating and capital reserves. They still aren't quite adequate yet. Talk about the change in landscape for ACTA and regarding our trips starting in another year. Everybody's aware that the Burlington-Gibsonville fixed route will go into operation June of 2016, and that is going to affect our trips and what we run. Approximately 15 to 20%, we're estimating, of ACTA's urban business will hopefully move over to the fixed route. We've worked with the City of Burlington and the MPO to identify those riders that we have, and they're using that information to, they use that information to help plot their routes and also some of the destinations, so that those that can ride that fixed route can move over to that. Okay, and what that will do is free up some of our trips to look at the next layer of opportunities, and so that's what we're looking at. Some of the things that we're considering. We want to operate the complementary paratransit for the new fixed route system. And somebody asked me, what's complementary paratransit? And somebody said, well, that's where somebody gets on and you compliment them. Well, that's not what it is. The fixed route that goes into place, within 3/4 of the mile of that route, either direction, if someone is not physically able to get to the route to ride the bus, They go through a certification process, and you have to, as a fixed route, provide equivalent service. And that equivalent service would be somebody that would go to their house and pick them up and take them to their destination. So that's complimentary paratransit. And that is very close to what we do today. We do door-to-door service, and we think that that is just an extension of what we're doing. So we plan on going after that and bidding on that piece of bidding on that business. We're also looking at bidding on the fixed route for Burlington and Gibsonville. Our board of directors feels that ACTA is a local group, and we'll talk about this in a second, but being a local provider, there's some advantages that we can offer Burlington and Gibsonville. We're looking at also providing some other connector services such as ACC. And we also want to increase our rural trips. We have ROPE funds that are earmarked for the county, and we think that it's probably been underutilized because we've been using a lot of those funds for the city in the past. Now we've got to focus on expanding those available funds out to the county. In looking at the complementary paratransit, some of the positives that would make us want to do that, the fixed route, as I said, must provide the ADA complementary paratransits for individuals with disabilities that cannot use the fixed route, or for some reason they can't get to the stops. Like I say earlier, that's the type of business that we do today, so it's very similar, and we're just a natural to do that. We'd be able to leverage our existing infrastructure, our drivers, our training, our drug testing, our scheduling, the management process, all consolidated into one structure. And we can absorb it without adding anything. We've got the equipment, we got the staff, so is very favorable for us to do that. We recently also expanded three vehicles, and that will allow us to do priority trip service. One thing about the complementary paratransit, the FTA has very strict guidelines on your own time service. You have to be up in the high 90 percentages, and they only give you a 30-minute window, either 15 minutes in front of or 15 minutes behind for on-time delivery. And so that'll be a challenge. Most likely we include many of the existing ACTA riders. And the other thing about complimentary, it'll be even easier if you can get the fixed route because it's within your one unit to coordinate those. The negatives about complementary paratransit that our board looked at, the tight FTA guidelines for on-time performance. It's potentially less flexibility for vehicles that may have to be restricted to just doing the service. There's also a lot of time required to do the screening, and who does the screening? Would it be the City of Burlington, or would it be ACTA? Would have to look at that. And sometimes there's a tendency to underestimate the percentage of trips that would be complementary paratransit. I know standard is generally about 25%. I think the MPO probably thinks it's 4 or 5%. So we'll see where that goes. Then looking at the fixed route, our board looked at and looked at the positives would be potential lower costs to the city and the taxpayers to select a non-unionized entity like ACTA. Other people that are going to be competing for this outside of the county will be large national companies, and more than likely they'll be unionized at a higher cost. We would be able to leverage our existing infrastructure, and also DOT encourages a unified system. They would rather see one group in the county running everything versus having somebody doing rural and somebody doing complimentary paratransit and somebody doing fixed. That means they have oversight for three groups rather than one, so they'd rather have this in one place. Greater flexibility for Burlington with dealing with an inside in the county versus an outside company. And I think ACTA has the ability to be a conduit for what could happen in the county later on with some of the other municipalities that eventually may join this, and there may be an opportunity for the county to become involved in this as you look at the entire structure of Alamance County. To do this, ACTA would look and at bringing in a fixed route administrator, somebody that has a fixed route and DOT experience. We would leverage this contract person plus some new staff that we would have to hire. And the other thing is we already have relationships with city and county elected officials, and a good thing for this would be a potential for a central location site somewhere in Burlington, probably. Negatives, ACTA does not run a fixed route system right now, so we're relatively inexperienced in that. We do some deviated fixed routes that are similar, but we think that with a consultant coming in and joining us, we will probably have a one-up on some of the other potential service providers. There may be some people that would favor an outside service because they think ACTA is too small, or we're inexperienced, or we lack reserve dollars, and I don't disagree with the reserve dollars. We don't have a lot, but we have worked out with through Craig. The problem with 5307 money is you have to do the work in advance and then get reimbursed. It's probably 9 to 12 months after you've already done the work. So that means you've, in our case, next year we've got $300,000 of service in our budget. And so the board, Craig, has agreed to advance us those monies to keep us going from a cash flow perspective. And then when we file and get reimbursed, we'll clear the receipt payable to the county, and we appreciate that. A negative is that we're trying to overcome here is we haven't really talked to you about this, and we're trying to get your support for us moving ahead on this, even though it's not going to cost the county any money. And I'll talk about that in a second. There is a potential that it could increase the health care costs for ACTA because we'd be going over 50 FTEs. And so that's something that we're having to look at. And the cost to submit a bid is going to be $5,000 to $10,000, and that would be out of our pocket. That would cost ACTA in our reserves. It's obviously going to take a lot of time and administrative effort here. And we don't have a current facility beyond our existing lease. It expires at the end of the year, but we're working on that. Those are the negatives. That from a organization standpoint, you can see this is our current organization, which we have about 34 to 35 FTEs. We would be adding this consultant right here and then hiring these positions. Some of these positions could come from our existing staff. Some of our drivers could come from our existing staff, but that's the organization that we would have to handle the fixed route system. It'll be about 10 people. The implications for service, there's going to be no impact for the general public trips that we do, or the elderly disabled trips, or Medicaid. We'll continue to do that as planned. We will hire additional staffing to do the fixed route plus a consultant. We'll absorb the complimentary paratransit with our existing staff, and we will need to consider that we'll have to house six new buses for the Burlington fleet. So the next steps for ACTA is to communicate the plans to you guys today and hopefully hear your feedback and gain your support. We're going to engage a fixed route consultant. We sent out a RFP the 1st of June, and I talked with four different consultant groups. We got one plan that was submitted to us. Our boards evaluated it. They met all of our criteria. So I'm in process of finalizing the negotiated contract this week, and we will have them on board hopefully before the end of the week. We're excited about this particular group. It's AECOM. We will receive a request for proposal from the MPO in September. They'll be bidding the complimentary paratransit, and they'll be bidding the fixed route out separately. And which I show you right there. We'll have to have the responses back in November. They will make the award of the contracts in December or January. And if we're awarded the fixed route contract, we'll complete our hiring and staffing and training with implementation of the operations by June of 2016. There's a picture of our bus. Everybody's probably familiar with ACTA and our logo in the back there. A typical client right there. We serve all of Alamance County, and there's the county seal. We're looking to join in with Burlington and their fixed route. Another picture. So with that, I'll close and just you're welcome to make any comments to me that you'd like, but we're just looking for your support. Financially, our bid on the fixed route, we would be bidding at a rate per hour to the MPO. That would cover all of our costs, so there's no other local money that would require here. For the complimentary paratransit, your continued support as you normally have to provide seed money for us to run those type of trips would be required.
Thank you. Questions? Comments?
Well, I'll say, serving on the board, I think we appreciate everything that Ralph has done. He's doing a fine job at leading the organization. You know, this ACTA is in the transportation business. It's not just the response demand rides out in the country necessarily. That's what we've been out in the county and doing the urban trips too. But if you look at the core competencies of the agency, I'm talking about fleet management, driver training, management of grants. We're managing 27 vehicles right now, and everything that goes along with that, it doesn't seem like rocket science to add a fixed route service to what we're already doing, and we'll have the horsepower to do that as well if we're able to get that bid. So,
Ralph, and you're looking for a location, being in the real estate business, what are your needs, and where are you guys thinking about as a location?
We're looking at probably a minimum of say 4,000 square feet. But even more important, we're going to have space to park all those vehicles.
Yeah.
And the buses require more than a standard car space. So the thought has been that we would be somewhere in the urban area where they would be centrally located. And I'll just give you, for example, we've looked on Mebane Street up and down, having some discussions with somebody about the Toyota dealership out on North Church,
right.
But there's a building available on South Mebane Street that could develop into something. And here again, the county has also, I've been working with Richard Hill and looking at space, and we thought we had a potential, and we do have a potential to locate behind the health department. There is about 3 acres of land there, right there at the rescue squad.
Turn there.
And it would have to be developed and potentially put some, just drop a couple of units in there for offices, but there's a pad there. We also need to factor in, we would like to have a fueling station for propane. And so that...
There are pretty specific regulations on that as to...
There are. For example, if we were to do the one behind the health department, some zoning changes would have to be done. Richard said, yeah, that's an obstacle, but it could be overcome. Now, temporarily, since we looked at what retail fueling stations would be available, and Payne Oil has one right near Graham. It's about 3 miles from where we are. So rather than purchasing right now, we may decide to use that, not knowing that what our facility is going to work out to be. So that might be the option we look at straight up. But does that kind of give you an idea of what we're looking for?
Any further comments or questions? Well, thank you, sir.
Thank you for your support.
Yep,
sir. All right, next on the agenda is the discussion of regular meeting dates and times. Anybody like to?
Well, I just want to make a notice that a lot of the morning meetings, I noticed that there's not a lot of input from the public. I see a lot of...
It's packed this morning.
Yeah, but most of them staff, sir.
I don't think so. Mayor's here.
Well, the mayor, but the only thing is a lot of the people that come in the mornings, I've noticed, are staff, and that's just my perspective. It doesn't really matter. I think the purpose of the morning meetings was to get more citizen involvement, so...
I think the issue is that a lot of senior citizens have a hard time driving at night, particularly during the winter months. And
I drive. I mean, it's true. We can't see.
Can't hear.
I'm
dark.
I've been in here for a year and a half now. I think I'm in that category, except I can still see.
The bike, right?
You know, we've the community college has moved their meetings to 6 o'clock rather than 7, and of course they don't have the number of folks coming in, you know, from citizens, you know, coming in that we do. But you know, for the afternoon meetings, so we might want to consider that maybe instead of a 7 o'clock meeting, maybe a 6 o'clock meeting, where you're not hanging around, you know, later. I don't know how this board feels about that, but I'll throw that out there.
I'm okay, whatever.
And I don't have strong feelings one way or another, really.
I don't either.
And we want the judge to be able to get here safely.
We can pick you in it, sure.
Send an active back.
Can you manage that?
We'll extend our hours for you.
From what I'm hearing from the board, though, it looks like, I'm fine either way, and I think that's what I'm hearing from everybody. It sounds like probably we're just going to leave them like they are right now.
That's good by me.
That's good. Unless I hear different.
Leave it right along.
You know,
we can always change if...
Yeah. Yeah, and I like the afternoon meetings, and because it gives you time to do what you need to do during the day.
The only thing I might say is if citizens feel like it's better evening and night, let their voices be heard,
yeah,
and
yeah,
we can adjust accordingly.
Yeah, and that's a great idea.
Well, the agenda means a lot, too. I mean, you know, you got to decide whatever's on the agenda is going to draw people, and if there's nothing on the agenda the public cares about, they're not going to come out.
So whether it's day or night.
Yeah.
You're right.
Yeah, you're right.
It's up to the manager. He needs to shape up over here.
Yes, sir.
Well, Joe, I think you had a pretty good one, the agenda today. What do you think? Okay, no action taken on that one. How does this sound for the time being, other than encouraging the citizens to let us know how you feel about it? And Move on to nomination of commissioner representative for the North Carolina Association of County Commissioners Executive Board. I would like to put the name Dan Engel out there.
I would second that name.
All right.
I ain't got a problem.
Further comments? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Thank you. That's just for the public. That is a it's something that's shared in District, I think it's 11.
Yes, sir.
It's shared by the counties. It gets around. It's about, is it eight counties?
Yes, sir.
Eight counties. So every eight years it comes up our term. I think our last one was Larry Sharp.
Yes, sir.
And before that, W.B. Junior Teague, and I think they were both chairman at the time. So
that would be appropriate.
Well, thank you. That takes care of that. County manager's report.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Really just go over a couple of dates, if we could. Just a reminder that August 12th will be a facilities committee meeting with ABSS at 9:30 on Vaughn Road. So that's our joint committee meeting. So that's August 12th. August 13th is our city-county dinner hosted by the City of Burlington at Lake McIntosh at 6 p.m. And we really need to reschedule our strategic planning meeting. As the board's aware, there was some conflict with the August 28th date. And we have a couple of dates to consider if the board is agreeable. One is September 1st, which is a Tuesday. September 8th, which is a Tuesday. September 10th, which is a Thursday. And September 24th, which is a Thursday. And that would be from 9:30 in the morning until 5:25. We've worked with the hospital, and they're going to let us use one of the rooms at the Wellness Cancer Center, whatever it's called now, Bob.
It's the
facility.
I guess it's the Colon Health / Alamance Regional Cancer Center.
Okay.
There's a really beautiful conference room there. And if that doesn't work, they have a really nice room in the Medical Arts. No, not Medical Arts, the Grand Oaks building.
Yes, sir. So if any of those days and Liberty, you want to say? Anything? Do you need to say anything? Or? But if, just tell us what date works and we'll get back with Lydian. The 1st, 8th, 10th, or
24th. Sounds good. We'll let you know.
Okay. I hate to rush, but as soon as possible, if we could.
It all works for me.
Okay. I understand.
All right.
And me also.
And I do will get with the chairman and vice chair about a facilities committee meeting. And remind you that the state of Alamance County, the meeting that is provided by the Piedmont Triad Business Journal is August 14th at 7:30 a.m. at ACC. And Mr. Chairman, if we could adjourn the meeting after you've done, we have that dedication downstairs in the lobby.
Yes, sir. You've completed your report.
Yes, sir.
I apologize to folks.
I'm sorry.
I have some both legs sitting up here. I hate to do that stand up. All right. Commissioners' comments. Any comments from our commissioners?
I think we made enough.
Having none, meeting is adjourned to the downstairs. We have a, as our county manager said, a memorial for our good friend Don Wilson that just passed away. So we will be in the foyer downstairs on the first floor.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.